together we can work to make a difference in our society. So let me just briefly explain the District 16J agenda for this incoming year. Implementing global membership approach at club and zone level and prepare extended sustainable membership growth plans. Improve Lions image through public relations. Improving the service impact by promoting hands-on services. Empowering youth through service initiative. Inclusion of all clubs and transparency in the district administration. Enhancing coordination between traditional and the new clubs. Helping our clubs with resources from Lions Club International. Comprehensive learning opportunities through virtual and in-person workshops throughout the year. Improving inter-club and district communication. Our international president is asking us to serve from the heart. Together, we can build successful plans for sustainable leadership development, membership satisfaction, and service impact. This leadership refresher training is a perfect example of Together We Can. New Jersey Lions, all three districts are working together for the impactful service year. So let's shake hands together and unite. Our district agenda can only happen through love and kindness. Looking forward to working with you all. Thank you so much. And now over to Lion Rohel.
Thank you, Lion Varsha, for the enlightenment on the agenda. Before we go to the crux of tonight's session, there are two lions I'd like to call for a few words of wisdom. First, let us welcome incoming Council Chair Armando Guerra.
Thank you to Jatia, Rohel Batista. It's truly an honor to be as a council chair elected. I'm looking forward to working with all the New Jersey Lions, and I'm looking to continue to serve the community with all of you. And I want to thank all people that are over here working through the virtual leadership refresher. We really appreciate all your time and all your knowledge. Thank you.
Thank you, Light Armando. And now, here is incoming Multiple District 16 GLT Coordinator Anu Chitnis to introduce our presenter for tonight. Lion Anu.
Okay, can you hear me, Lion Rohel?
Yes, loud and clear.
Okay, yeah, no, I think we are maxed out on our bandwidth. It seems like all three of us on Zoom video. So that's the reason why I've stopped my video, so that I don't get disconnected. This is Lion Anu Chitnis. Most of you on the Zoom probably have met me at some point in time or the other. For the ones who do not know me, I'm Lion Anu Chitnis from District 16J. I will be incoming Multiple District GLT Chair for year 2021-2022. I'm here today to introduce our esteemed speaker, PID Sangeeta Jatia. If I read her professional bio, we may actually use up significant amount of time from her presentation. So in order to introduce this very accomplished, highly accomplished lion, all I'm going to say is that PID Sangeeta Jatia from Kolkata, West Bengal, India, who is currently in Canada, taking care of her grandchild, and still finding time to do variety of Lion projects, and here today to talk to us, extremely fortunate to have her here. She was on the board of Lions International as a PID, as a director. She was on the board from 2012 through 2014. I'm sorry, my bandwidth may be an issue. I don't know if everyone can hear. So if someone can please put in chat if my voice, if I'm still audible, that'll be great. Okay, thank you. So PID Sangeeta has been Lion for many, many years. I think Lion Mahesh and I, if I ever have any doubt on any part of Lion's knowledge, she is the one who we probably would go to. So I cannot think of a better Lion to come here and talk about Lions and in general member orientation. She is, as I said, a very accomplished Lion. In recognition of her service to the association, she has received numerous awards, including Lion of the Year, Membership Advancement Key, 6 Extension Awards, 11 International Presidential Awards, and the list goes on. And the list goes on. But I think above and beyond everything, I am honored and privileged to call her my friend on and off Facebook. Thank you, Sangeeta ji, for coming and talking to us today.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Anu. And that's the advantage of coming to a district where you have so many friends, where you know and understand, they know you, and they'll always speak good about you. So that's really, really nice. So Varsha, thank you for this invitation. To all of you present here, it's such a pleasure to be in New Jersey. I've had the occasion to be there in your meetings once, twice, maybe thrice. And each time has been such fun to know people. And I think that's what Lionism is all about. Today, Varsha's told me to speak about what is Lions and to tell you what this organization is all about. I stay in Kolkata, India, far away from New Jersey. But if there's a chance that I can travel to that part of the world, the first person I would think of would probably be Mahesh, his family, and of course, the Lions of New Jersey. Why? Because that is the bond that we have developed over the years. And that is the first person whose name comes to my mind when there is an emergency and one of my friends requires some support near New York. Why? Because of this great organization and because of the same lapel pin that both of us wear. There's nothing beyond. We didn't know each other, even though he was in India, I didn't know him. But when you come and I met him at one of these international forums, the US-Canada forum, and since then that bond has developed and we've been meeting, talking, wherever. And these, you know, these meetings have now made us tremendous friends. That's what Lionism is all about. Two people from different parts of the world come together. Now the entire family becomes a great friend. And I think I meet Ojas more than I meet Mahesh these days. And that's how it's all developed. And that's how I believe is the, you know, the definition of Lionism. It gives us a family away from family. It gives us a network of individuals whom we can work with to make this world a better place. It gives us a reason to make or work together. It gives us a reason to come together on a platform. That is exactly what Lions Clubs International is. It gives us a platform. You know, many of us do service from homes. We do all kinds of little charities. We do a whole lot of things. But even like, I'm sure like each of our religions, even if you are a non-believer, we always believe in doing some kindness. But when we do some kindness through this platform, that's what makes a difference. And why do we need a platform? Because at times you want to do some good. You want to do something, but you do not know how to do it. I have food left over and I would like to give it to somebody. Now, whom do I contact? I have clothes, a whole lot of clothes which I don't need anymore. Now, whom do I give it to? I don't know. I have books in my homes, clothes, toys, so many things which I would just like to get rid of, but I don't know whom do I go and give it to. Just ask a Lion and they'll give you so many examples. This is what you can do. You want to do good? Just go and catch a Lion. I think that's what Lions do. They are men and women, young and old, all kinds of people from all walks of life who come together. And what they do is work together as a team to make the world a better place. They are not extraordinary, but the kind of work that they do, that makes them extraordinary. Ordinary people in normal settings just who have the will to make that difference, a will to give a little bit of time, their talent and their energy. Sometimes it's surprising. All that we, you know, whenever we come to a Lions Club meeting, all that we do is give maybe our time, give our talent and give our treasure. All three are required. But then we come back again. In spite of the fact that we're always giving, we come back again. What pulls us there? What is that magnet that is right there which pulls us to any Lions Club anywhere in the world? The magnet is the bonds that we create, the networks that we have, and most importantly, the passion in each of our hearts which beats to the tune of we serve. I think that's what is important. So Lions are no extraordinary people, but believe me, to those whom we serve, we become extraordinary, become superhuman beings, and for them, we are definitely superheroes. We are ordinary people wearing the garb or trying to do something which is a little good, being a little kind, or when we wear this lapel pin, it always reminds us, you've got to be kind. You are different because you wear this lapel pin. And because you wear this lapel pin, people are going to be looking at you with a different eye, with a different vision, because they believe you will be ready to serve. And that's what Lions do, ready to serve all the time. Are Lions rich people? Are Lions ordinary? Where do they come from? All kinds. They are people who are rich in their hearts. They have, even if they have little, they want to give of that little. I come from the city of Kolkata where Mother Teresa lived, and Mother Teresa always said, give till it hurts. Even if you have something, you know, if you have something and you just have a little bit of something, but if you would like to share it with that somebody, you become richer. And that's exactly what it is. And Lions, as Lions, we are always there. We call ourselves always asking for others, always asking from others. Whenever we are in a Lions Club meeting, either we are raising funds for something, we are doing something for somebody else. We are always asking, not for ourselves. We are asking for others. And I think that is what is important. It is very easy. It is very easy when you can put your hands in your pockets and give out some money or give it out to somebody. That's very simple. But when you go out into the world, ask people to donate so that we can work together or do some service, I tell you, it's very difficult. But Lions have the heart to do that. Lions can do that. And Lions continue to do that. We are, I believe, the best fundraisers in the world. And what do that with that fund? The best part of our fundraising is every penny, every cent that we collect is used for charity. We do not use it for administration. That's why the Lions brand is a very special brand. All the administrative work is done by the volunteers themselves, and they stand out and do that. But whatever anybody donates goes directly to the beneficiary. That's why Lions makes its name in one of the best, you know, charity navigators. If you look at them, they make their name right there because we don't spend any money on administration. Our foundation runs without any administrative costs. Now you will ask, how are the administrative costs met? Very simple. All the money that we have over the years, the reserves, the interest that we accrue out of that goes towards the administrative costs. So whatever people give now goes straight to charity. That's the strength of the Lions Clubs and our foundation, which is definitely a part of Lions. So what do? Now you will ask, what is the services that you do? What are the kind of things that you do? There are as many countries as we are in. We are in above 200 countries. And in the same number of ways, even much more, we do service. We serve, we are global. We are global in our thinking, but we are local in our approach. How do we do that? We look and listen to our communities. We see what are the needs of that particular community. We look at what people require there. And when we can identify a need, that's when the Lions get into action. They get into action and they do the projects. Different parts of the world, the needs are different. The country where I come from, Lions invest a lot of money and energy in healthcare projects. Lions run blood banks. Lions run eye hospitals. lions run huge hospitals, but probably that's not possible in many parts of the world. In some parts of the world, the programs that we do is even, you know, it's just beyond running these institutions. In places like Australia, lions even do work in research. Lions are doing research work in pediatric cancer. We run the guides dog schools. We run the diabetes dog schools. We run a whole variety of clinics. And then lions do these ad hoc projects where we are serving food to the needy. We are giving medicines to those who need it. Whenever there's a calamity, a natural calamity, lions are there to support. We run environment projects. Name it, the lions do it. In fact, our menu is so huge, sometimes it'll just stagger you. Of course, we have our core areas. For many years, we started in 1917. 1917, Melvin Jones, who was the founder of Lionism, it was right after World War, and he wanted to, you know, the world was ravaged. The people wanted to do something for each other, build the community. And these businessmen came together and said, let's get together, work together, and see if we can also do some good in our community so that we can restore all that we have lost. The ideals from 1917 remain the same. Of course, they have changed over the years. What started as one businessman's club has grown to some 47,000 clubs across the globe. Just imagine, 47,000 clubs. You have three districts here. And across the world, there are around 750 districts. Now, what are clubs? What are districts? I'm going to come to that too. But first, let me tell you what lions do is, we do any kind of service. So in different parts of the world, we do different kinds of services, I was telling you. So from 1917, we started doing these small projects, started getting together. And then as they grew and went into different countries, the first country that we moved on out of United States was definitely Canada. And from Canada, it moved on to Europe and then all over the world. And now we proudly proclaim that we are in 210 countries and geographical areas. Lions is in more places than the United Nations has members. Can you just believe that? That is our kind, that is the kind of outreach that we have. Lions name, you go to any place, any small town, any small village, any small city, and you will definitely see a Lions logo right there. What does it mean? It means that there are some individuals in that city, or that town or that village, when you can go to, and believe me, they will be ready to help, because that's what the Lions believe in. Our motto is, we serve. We serve through our hands, we serve with our talent, and we also serve with treasure. That's what Lions do. So, as I said, our projects are innumerable. So many projects that we take up, and then again, it depends on what is required. So we look at our community, we make an assessment, we do a needs assessment, and then we decide. And of course, the members of the club must be interested in doing that service. Some members are interested in doing service for the children. Some like to work with the elderly. Some like to work with health programs. Some like to work with food programs. Some like to work with environment projects. Whatever you want. And we proudly say every club has their own identity, and they can take up any project that they want to. It must, you know, appeal to the members. It must be a project that the members are fond of doing, and the Lions Clubs International will allow you to do any project possible. Very, very interesting projects Lions have taken up. We also have, as I said, a core area. We started with our, you know, vision being our core area in 1925. Helen Keller, I'm sure you all have heard of Helen Keller, the lady who transformed the world. She herself could not see or talk but she had this incredible talent, which she was brought forth by her tutor, Anne Sullivan. Helen Keller addressed the lions around the conventions, and she spoke and she said, why don't the lions take up the cause of the visually challenged? And she said, Today, I am standing over here as your opportunity. I am an opportunity, and why don't you open the door and let me in? And lions, please become the knights of the blind. In answer to that call, lions started taking up service activities related to vision, and lions became known for as knights of the blind. We do vision screenings, we do cornea drafting, we do cornea donations, we do cataract surgeries. We run these river blindness programs in Africa. In the more advanced countries, we have the dog guide programs, we have the white cane programs. Wherever, whatever works, the lions work for the visually impaired. We have these braille programs. We have sensory parks. Another thing for the visually challenged who really cannot see anything. In Austria, the lions did such a beautiful project for the visually challenged. I mean, this is thinking out of the box, and that's what I mean, that lions do different things in different parts of the world. What they did there was they realized that those who were visually challenged could not see those beautiful monuments, the beautiful churches that Austria is so famous for. So what they did, in front of every church, you will find a small replica of that church, which the visually impaired can go and touch and feel and understand what that particular church looks like. That's also a lion's project, right? Then, for the visually impaired, what are the other things that lions can do so that we can understand what it means to be visually impaired? Many clubs across the world, around the world, hold what we call these special nights when everybody is invited for dinner. And as you come in for dinner, you are blindfolded. You're blindfolded and you have to have that meal in complete blindness, just so that everybody can understand what it is to have or live a life like that. To create these kind of awarenesses, to make people understand, to empathize, learn empathy, that's what lions do. And big or small, we run hundreds of projects. In my part of the world, again, I would just come back. I come from Eastern India. And in Eastern India, you won't believe, lions run 68 eye hospitals. 68 eye hospitals, small and big. Some hospitals where about 100,000 surgeries are done per year. Yes, 100,000 surgeries done per year. And there are some that are small, which may be 100 surgeries done in a month. So you've got all kinds of hospitals, but lions are running them. They are not professionally run. They are run by lions. We run blood banks. We run schools. We run environment projects, we run just about everything. And I know a whole lot of projects are running even in New Jersey. And I'm sure as you look around, and I'm sure your district governor-elect will tell you what the wonderful projects that lions run in New Jersey too. I know of those very many feeding programs that you've been doing in the last couple of months, the way during the pandemic, you have been rising to the occasion and coming out, because that was probably the only thing that we could do sitting at home, but you put together those kits, the food bags, and you distributed them. That's service, my dear friends. So whatever is the need, wherever is the need, lions come forward and do that. So what are clubs? When a group of individuals get together, they form a club. Now these clubs we are required to meet at least once a month. You can meet more often if you want, and this meeting can be in any place. It can be any setting. You can have a meeting over a meal. And now we also have meetings over the net. You can have meetings during a service project, before or after. You can do it any way. Your club, you can run your way. But it is necessary that you have at least one meeting a month so that you can carry out service activities. You can talk about what you want to do. And together with that service, what is very important is that fellowship. You know, most of our clubs have become small families. All of us know each other, and whether there is good or bad in anybody's families, the lions are there, the friends are there, and slowly from the club, we become one big family. And these 46,000 families, which of sizes varying from maybe 10 members in a club to maybe 300 members in a club, we have all numbers and you are at will. We start a Lions Club with 20 members and we suggest that a club should at least have 20 members, but then clubs grow to large numbers and sometimes members are last and the club also might shrink. But an optimum number that we believe is a good one is 20. And most of the clubs do definitely have 20 members. So they get together, they meet, as I said, decide on a program, enjoy some fellowship, share programs together. Like if there's any festival coming up, we will work together for the festival. Then we will also raise funds, and raising funds also brings us together again. So Lions, that's what we do. Service, fellowship, fundraising, break bread together, eat together, work together, and serve together. That's what Lions do. Then the Lions clubs, a number of clubs, again, get merged together to form a zone. A few zones merge together or come together to form a region. You will soon hear about it. And I'm sure you would have heard the word zone, region, and all the clubs in one area come together. There are at least 35 clubs need to be there, and they form what we call a Lions district. A Lions district has a district governor as the chief executive officer there, and the district governor has a team who works to look after the administration of that very district. In a club, you have various positions. Of course, the president, secretary, treasurer are there, and you have a board of directors, and you have some fun positions. The best part about a Lions Club is each individual who's on the board is given one particular responsibility. Nobody has to do everything. You are given a small little job to do. For example, we have in our clubs that lion tamer. What's the job of a lion tamer? Very simple. He or she carries the gong gavel, the banner, carries all this, what we call the property of a Lions Club. And he or she is in charge of that. So she must be there or he must be there at every meeting before the meeting starts and the meeting ends, because we use a gong and gavel to start the meeting. And the banner is something that we like to have during our meetings. So that is what is the job of a lion tamer. Then we also have somebody called a lion tail twister. I'm just giving you a few examples. Now, this tail twister's job is to keep the atmosphere of the club absolutely, light, fun, so that people, when we get into arguments, sometimes when we discuss, we don't realize how high our volumes also go, right? Sometimes we get into debates and that's absolutely fine. Everybody doesn't have to have the same viewpoint. You can have different opinions, but importantly, the job of the tail twister is to maintain that balance. If he finds that things are really heating up, comes in like a court jester, comes in and makes a kind of a joke, a song, plays a song, and that's the only job of a tail twister is to keep the temperatures in the meetings down and to keep the excitement going, to keep the atmosphere very lively. That's the job of the tail twister. And then you have a membership chairperson, you have a public relations officer, you have a club administrator, whole lot of things. I'm not going to talk about all of that. But what I mean to tell you is that each person has a specific responsibility, a small responsibility. And when then each of them work together, they kind of make the club play. It's like a symphony, everybody playing the little part, but if one doesn't play the part, there is a little discord. But if each one plays the part, it's not very difficult. And now with all our e-reporting, you can well imagine, 46,000 clubs, I told you, right? 750 districts. And we have a head office, which is situated in Oak Brook, Illinois, right outside Chicago. And in that office, all our records are kept. We have a huge staff of around, I think, 190 or 200 staff members over there who look after, do all the record keeping. But of course now with total digitization, it has become much more simpler. Each and every member's record is kept at the headquarters. And the moment you become a member, your name gets enrolled over there and you get a particular number, it's there and that's unique to you. Even if you leave this organization, that number is always going to be there against your name. And that records all your service activities, all that you have done, all the donations that you have made, everything is recorded in that number. So that becomes kind of your I would say, a place that you could go to find out how much or how many years you have served in this organization, what you have served, in which position you have served. So all these records of every individual member of every individual club is kept at Lions Clubs International. Now, how do they know this? This record is sent to them via a, you know, we have an app, we have a full website, and through that, the club secretaries or the presidents or the club administrator are required to fill in that data and send it to Lions Clubs International. Now, that data is very, very simple to fill up. It's no rocket science. Very easy steps. And what all that we need to do is, you know, put in those numbers, tell them how much service you have done. If you've taken a new member, you put that in. If you've had a meeting, you put that in. Whatever you do in a Lions Club, you just go key it in there. It just doesn't take more than 5 or 7 minutes. And then those records are there for posterity. And your club records are maintained on that cloud system. So you can always go back and find out what you had done, provided you put in the records there, right? So you've got to key it in. And it's very important that after every service activity you do, you key in what you did so that it can all be aggregated and we can understand the kind of services Lions are doing across the globe. So this is how we operate. We operate as a club. All club records are kept at Lions Clubs International. You've got to feed in that record, and the club secretary, the club president, or the club administrator does that filling in of the data. And this is aggregated to for us to understand what is the quantum of work Lions are doing all over the globe. Phenomenal. If you would just hear the figures, it's staggering. Lions, really, almost every minute. Because if you are, it's evening in New Jersey, it's getting morning in some other place, right? So people are always on the job. 24 hours Lions are working, and somewhere in the world, Lions are doing some service activity. It's a job which all the individuals, the 1.3 million members that we have, are always on the job. And that's what makes Lions Clubs International such a special place to be. So how do we choose what we want to do? Now, how do we choose whether we want to do an educational program, a health program, an environment program? It's all up to you. It's absolutely up to you what you want to do. You as a club member, when during a club meeting, required to decide what is the project that you want to take up. It's up to you. It can change year to year. You can do the same project year after year. It's all in your hands. Again, as I said, your club, you run your way. You can do whatever project that you want. And people really take up some very innovative projects. Some Leos in Sri Lanka, you know, I had never thought this was possible. What they started doing was they started taking care of coral reefs. I had never heard that Lions were taking care of coral reefs, but the Leos said, you know, soon the oceans will be bereft of the coral reefs because people are taking them off. And they started cultivating coral. And that's the Lions project. Now, that's so different, is it not? So Lions work with programs, various programs, and we have, vision was our core area for many years, but now we have 5 core areas that we work with. What are those 5 core areas? Youth, caring for the youth, looking after the youth, doing programs for the youth, and we have very many youth programs in the organization, which you can look into. I mean, there's so much, I mean, I can go on talking about youth programs for an hour because we have so many youth programs in our organization. Specifics, I would just name them: Lions Quest, Peace Poster, Young Ambassadors. There are hundreds and hundreds of programs that Lions are doing with the youth. Then we have a focus on vision. That has been our, you know, like constant focus. The third one is we are also now working very, very strongly for combating diabetes. How do we address diabetes? And again, as I said, vision, people all over the world look at vision in a different way. Similarly, diabetes too. In some parts of the world, Lions run diabetes clinics. In some parts, what they are doing is diabetes detection. In some parts of the world, they have diabetes gyms, diabetes parks. In some parts of the world, they have training diabetes dogs who can smell whether their master has a you know, low sugar or high sugar, and can inform them accordingly. That is the way Lions also doing work. We have very many other diabetes programs where Lions are, you know, kind of, Varsha here works with the Zumba program. And she, you know, motivates Lions that you must do Zumba for a healthy lifestyle. During the last, in the pandemic, in the last 18 months, we have so many virtual marathons. Lions have been so innovative. We used to do a lot of physical marathons. The Lions diabetes walks were very popular, the strides walks, as we call them. But now in the last 18 months, what we've had is these virtual marathons, virtual walks, and Lions have taken part in it. They can run, they can walk, they can sail, they can swim, they can do whatever they want, as long as they can clock some distance. And that's what Lions are doing. In fact, the most exciting, you know, we were supposed to have our international convention in Montreal, just starting next week. And the Lions of Toronto, they started, they could, obviously nobody could go to Montreal because the convention is now virtual. So what they did was they symbolically started walking towards Montreal. So, and that they are clocking their walk to Montreal, and that they are raising funds also, because as you walk, you ask friends to donate and they're donating to your walk. And this is how they're raising funds for diabetes. So Lions have been doing so many innovative things, so many different things. And diabetes is the next one, another focus area. Another focus area is hunger. We believe that that is one thing that we can definitely address in every part of the world. There are so many people who go to sleep hungry, who have no, not even one proper meal a day. And this is a need Lions are answering all over the globe also. And another very important program that Lions have adopted is pediatric cancer. In this, we are trying to find ways in which we can give some relief to those children who suffer from cancer, because we believe this is also a growing, you know, it's like a growing menace of society, the way cancer is spreading these days and children are being affected. So Lions would also like to address that. That does not mean that you cannot look at other projects. And of course, environment is another one. But you can look at any project that you want. And I'm sure you can persuade the Lions of your club to start that project. If you have the will, you have the heart in it, that's exactly what is required. There's nothing else. Lionism, you know, it becomes a way of life for people. It's not about going to a club meeting and doing service or talking about service. No, it's you live, you start living it every day. You start always thinking about how can you make something better. You keep thinking, how can I contribute? How can I, you know, do something for somebody else? How? And you learn all about kindness. You learn about sharing and you learn about serving. I think that's what Lions is. And the best, and I think the most important thing about Lions is we have this platform. It is all about, even, you know, it become, makes you a better human being. Because here we get an opportunity to learn administration, to learn leadership skills. And like you hold positions in your clubs in the districts, each one over here who spoke today holds a position. And how did they come to that position? You know, by walking up different steps. When I started in this organization, I could not even speak. I did not even, in fact, if somebody would put a mic in front of me, I would just run away. It was impossible for me to speak. And the first speech I remember when I had given, oh my, I still shudder to think what I had spoken and how I had spoken, because I still have some recollection of what I had said on that day. That day and today, today you can't stop me from speaking. Any opportunity, I would just love to speak. And that confidence has come because the opportunity that was given to me by this very platform. And I know many of you here would say just that. In your own clubs, you just see. I mean, one individual whom I have seen as a young boy, I saw him grow up and look how confident he is today, that he's running programs which are spanning the globe, which have people coming from all over the globe and speaking in that program. I know it's the Leo Club, but I know the vision behind it is that of Ojas Fitness. I think that's fantastic, just amazing for a young man whom literally I've seen grown up in you know, in front of my eyes. And I have seen the way he's developed. How? Not because of anything. Yes, of course, Mahesh and Anu have a big role to play. But I think the most important role is the platform that he got. The platform of Leo's that he got, where he could develop his skills. Otherwise, how do you go out and talk to people? How do you go out and understand what it is about administration? So I think this organization gives us a fantastic platform where we can grow ourselves. Each one of us grows. We grow in confidence. We grow in our network. And we grow in our skills. Because I believe each one, every individual has something special inside them. You know, not everybody can dance. Not everybody can sing. Not everybody can speak. Not everybody can do projects, but then everybody can do something, something which is remarkable. And this organization honors every skill that is there. If you're good in accounts, we need it as a treasurer. If you're good in administration or good in writing of reports, that's the club secretary's job. If you are good at going and talking to people, we say you can be a good marketing chairperson or you can be a good membership chairperson. Every single skill, you can find a corresponding job for a Lion member. And if you can get or own that skill, that makes that individual even better. And that does not only affect his Lionistic career or her Lionistic career, but I think it totally changes one's life. And I think that is exactly what Lions has done to us, changed our lives, absolutely changed it. What I was some 30 years back and what I am today can never be compared. We grew up in a family where we were always protected, came from a family where, you know, we were not allowed to go out and probably see the other part of the world. We were not allowed, or we never got an opportunity. But when I joined the Lions, I can tell you before that, probably, I can, you know, in one word, if I call myself, probably I was a spoiled kid. Had everything that was possible and did not even realize how people who don't have everything lived, because we were never shown that world. But the moment you join this organization, you come to understand how other people live. You understand, you learn so many things that you take for granted that it's not so easy for others. You start appreciating how difficult it is for those who are challenged in some way, because you are seeing what they are doing. You are seeing them. And that makes you, I think, a much better human being. You become more caring. And whatever Lions does, whatever else it does, it definitely makes you a better human being. That's for sure. And that cannot be learned in any other place, I would believe. No college, no institution, no university will ever teach you that. What we learn in this organization, it's something fantastic. It teaches us how to care. It teaches us diversity. It teaches us that they're different people. Each one comes with a different mindset. Each one has a different background. I mean, of course, people in the same household can have different mindsets, but here we are coming from different households. We are coming from different families with different backgrounds, different cultures, different upbringing. But when we come together, you learn how to respect each other. You learn what it means to accept different viewpoints. I remember a story when I was in Tunisia, which is in northern Africa. And that's a country which is a very small country, but a beautiful country. We were doing a program over there and we were organizing a forum over there, an Isame forum, because at that time in our area, we also had Africa and Tunisia was a part of that. Now, when we went there, they used to talk in French. And if you talk I know no French. So when we used to go there for our meetings, we used to have a translator. And naturally, it used to take a long time because, you know, when it gets translated into French, I don't know how it happens. When we translate it from French to English, it becomes shorter. But when you translate from English to French, it becomes much longer. Double the time. I don't know how it happens, but it always used to happen. So they always used to talk. So now, like normally, I'm sure when you do it in your meetings, you start with an invocation, do you? Do you start with an invocation? That's been our tradition. We used to start every meeting with an invocation. Now, we told them, okay, we are having this program and we're going to have an invocation at the beginning of the meeting because that's what we had learned Lions was all about, that we'll have an invocation. Now, when the moment I said the word invocation and somebody translated it, I could feel that a murmur amongst all the members, you know. And when they started talking in French, each one, you could make out that they were agitated. And I just thought to myself, here I'm just asking them to do an invocation. Why are they getting so agitated? Didn't figure out. I asked one, the lion who used to translate for us, you know, what is the matter? I can see there's a lot of agitation in the room. What is the discussion all about? I just said, you know, we'll do an invocation. Then he said, you know, the lions are saying, you would talk about invocation, but what about those who do not believe in God? Because when we translate into French, we can say God gets translated. But in Arabic, which is another language over there, God does not get translated into any other word. So how can you do that? And for what about the non-believers? Till then, I had never thought that, you know, we have to be mindful of everybody. And that was a great lesson. And then we had the invocation, but the invocation was all about nature. We did not talk about God or Allah or Christ or whoever. What we spoke about was nature and the gifts of nature. Now, that is a learning that we, you know, that we, as you go on in this organization, you learn how to take different people. Then there are different cultures. The culture that I come from, and in India, you know, normally if the husband is the governor, we tell the spouses, you must support the governor as much as you can. If the wife is the governor, we tell the husband, you must support the spouse. We take it for granted that the spouse will, you know, assist and work and spend all the time together. This is what we took for granted. That was our mindset at that point of time. This is something I'm talking about around 15 years back. Then I was asked to do some schooling for the DG district governors and the district governor spouses. I wrote out a letter to the district governor spouses and I told them, you know, you must support your spouses. You must work with them as they become governors. I'm sure the governors still get some kind of a letter like that asking, you know, for your spouses also or your partners in service that this is what you're required to do. You got to assist. Now, one lady from the, I remember it was United Kingdom, she sent a stinker of a mail and she said, what I and how I support my husband is my duty. Why are you telling me what I have to do? If I feel like doing it, I would do it. And if I don't want to do it, you can't dictate it to me. I was shocked. For a time, I didn't even understand where it came from. But then I realized it was a difference in culture. It was a difference in culture. It was nothing beyond that. She wasn't meaning any harm. She wasn't meaning any wrong. But what she did not like was my telling her that you must do this. This is your job. She said, no, that's not my job. He has chosen to become a district governor. That's his problem, not mine. And if I help him or not, it's up to me. At that point, I remember I was totally aghast. But now I understand it was a different viewpoint. And today, we've all come to understand that in this organization, there are different viewpoints and we must respect each one of them. And that, again, makes you a better human being. That makes you a better person. Even in other parts, you know, in other aspects of your life, you start applying the same principles. And I think that's really, really nice. So as I told you, our office is in Chicago. We run a huge, and the office supports our programs. And we have one of the finest foundations, the Lions Clubs International Foundation. Now that foundation is something that we contribute to. How does the foundation run? Lions give money. And when there is a, wherever there is a need, Lions can draw in through a grant. They can get a grant from the foundation to run small projects, big projects, large projects, huge projects, catastrophe projects. When there's an emergency, you get grants. So there is so much you can get out of our foundation, and the foundation is always there to support us. And the Lions keep supporting the foundation. And at this point of time, the Lions Foundation is running the largest fundraising campaign, the most ambitious fundraising campaign, which is called Campaign 100. We also have a youth wing, which is the Leo Clubs. And the Leos are the ones who really, okay, I'll come to the questions soon. And the Leo Clubs are the youth wing, and they keep, you know, we work with the, they are the ones who keep us young also, and we start working. And this is how, you know, they get inculcated into this organization. And I know the New Jersey Leos are just fantastic. And the kind of programs that you've been putting up, the kind of, I remember, I think you won that award also for the service, that kindness award, and for making a video. I think fantastic things that you've done. So Leos are an integral part of this organization. And I believe they are the ones who are giving us the run for the money and who are keeping us on our toes with their new things that they're always coming up with. So this is what it is. Membership is by invitation, but now we also, you know, you can find out, and you, if you want to become a member, you can definitely join, and you would love to have anybody joining in, because the more hands, the more hearts, the more people we can serve. That is why we need more and more people. So somebody asked me, asking a question. How do you stop club politics? Because I believe that is detrimental to membership. My question is very simple. Wherever there are human beings, there will always be politics. It's a church, it's a school, board, it's your home. Why anywhere else? Come to your home. Isn't there politics? We all know when to get our work done, how to get our work done. We have, I mean, where you guys, you know, don't have the joint families like we have back in India. Huge families staying together. There's more politics there than anywhere else. So wherever you are, friends, there are politics. So wherever they're going to be human, they're going to be politics. Now, good politics is good, but sometimes it gets a little ugly. But I believe in this organization, there is no place for real politics. All that is required is, I mean, after all, even if you have a position, why does politics come about? Because you want to hold a position, right? And here, positions mean you've got to give more of your time. So if the politics is there where people are wanting to fight to hold a position and they want to work, that's good politics, I believe. So it's okay. Any organization would have politics, and without politics, I think, you know, the charm of the organization is also lost. If everything was like absolutely perfect, you wouldn't enjoy it. So I believe wherever there'll be humans, there will be politics, and politics is also part of it. I don't think it's detrimental to membership. It is just how we take it. And sometimes it does get ugly, but then anything get ugly. It's up to you, up to the leadership to control it. So this is how, you know, this is what it is. And now if there are any questions, Varsha, I would love to answer the questions. I can see something in the chat box, but I'm not very sure it's a question or it's a comment.
Yeah, it's a comment.
Yeah, let's see. Well, yeah, we didn't see any question here. And first of all, that's a wow. Thank you so much, PID Sangeeta, for that illuminating, inspiring presentation on new members orientation. I really learned a lot. Yeah, I hope everyone too did. So if there's any question, please write them on the chat box, and we'll go to them after this, the second part, the next part. At this point, we will be having the questions and later on, right? But before we go there, I would like to call incoming State Advisor and PCC Mahesh Chitnis for a brief orientation on the multiple District 16 structure.
All right. I should not be following PID Sangeeta. I will not be able to do justice after what she has done. To the point that even if I was a part of Leo movement for a long time, the person who sort of gave me the orientation for the international organization was Lion PID Sangeeta. That time she was not even ID, and PID AP Singh. When we met in 2010 in Milwaukee, and we were sitting at a coffee shop, and AP and Sangeeta were giving me a sort of a rundown of how this association works. So I have a fond memories of learning these things about 11 years back. So I'm not going to attempt to compete with what PID Sangeeta was telling us about. I just want to add a couple of things that were not mentioned earlier about PID Sangeeta. Two things, and I think there is a question in the question pane, and we will reach to that later. PID Sangeeta is the, to lack of a better term, the architect of New Voices program. She was the first new ISS global coordinator and also the district governor elect seminar chair in 2018. So she is very much the authority on talking about new ISS and those programs. So before I hand it back over to her, I'm just going to go quickly over some facts about New Jersey Lions. New Jersey Lions have a proud history that all of us need to be proud of. Let me give you a little bit of background of how Lionism started in New Jersey. In around 1918, 1920, when we were actually going through another pandemic, the flu, influenza / Spanish flu, whichever that you call it. During that time, our founder, Melvin Jones, decided to grow our association. He was in a suburb of Chicago, and then he decided that he will go around and start building the clubs. That time, the mode of transportation was trains, the railroads. So he took a train from Chicago to go around. He went into the Upper Peninsula of Michigan, started Lions Clubs there, which started the multiple district 10. I'm going to talk about multiple district in a little bit. Then he came down to the Detroit and Southern Michigan. He started Lions Clubs there, which eventually was responsible for starting clubs in Canada. But that became the multiple district 11. He moved down to Ohio, became multiple district 13, moved to Pennsylvania, became multiple district 14, and then he crossed the Delaware River to come to New Jersey. And we had the whole of Northeast, the New York, New Jersey, Delaware, Maryland, Washington, D.C., and the New England. This was all multiple district 16 at one point of time. Now it has been split into multiple districts. Multiple district 20 is New York, multiple district 22 is Delaware, Maryland, Washington, D.C. With that, let me get into some facts about Lionism in New Jersey. As I was mentioning, just to give you a brief, PID Sangeeta did talk about our structure, but just to give you a little bit more structure about our association. Our building block is the club. Few of the members, to start a new club, we need 20, but they grow from any numbers. The largest club in the world is in India, or rather, first, I think three or four largest clubs are in India. The largest club is about, I think, 2,100 members or something like that, a huge number. But again, the clubs vary. Our average in New Jersey is about 25 members per club. Three, four such clubs come together, five clubs come together and become a zone. Two, three, four zones come together and become a region. Few regions make up a district. And then a few districts make up a multiple district. Our multiple district 16, has got three districts, 16 N, J, and L. In US mostly, every state has their own multiple district, but that is not the case worldwide. One district might have multiple countries. I know a couple of districts which have got like three or four countries involved. And then the multiple district, like few multiple districts become an area. Our area is area 1F, that is MD20, MD16, and MD22. And the whole of North America with the affiliated countries in Caribbean, English-speaking Caribbean, is constitutional area 1. We have 8 constitutional areas in the world. And then we became that whole international organization. And as PID Sangeeta mentioned, we have the largest footprint of any organization, any association in the world. We are into 210 countries and geographical areas. I just wanted to give that so that we can get a feel of where each of the entities stand. Okay, before I go there, we do have a few district officers that I will mention about. Again, I'm just going to open up the participants window so I won't miss anybody. I'm not going to introduce the incoming officers because I'm going to mention them later, but we do have our sitting governor, Kevin Kasubuki of 16J. We also have the state advisor, which is another position which is not being mentioned in the constitution bylaws of the international, but this is our local multiple district position called state advisor, who is a coordinator, who is a coordinator between the Council of Governors and the state office. The state advisor, we have sitting state advisor, Jack Romano here, past council chair Jack Romano. And we have past council chair Winston Ceballos is also on the call. Rest of the people I'll introduce because I'm going to talk about them when during the presentation. So what do you need to know as a new member? I would have given the club history, but we have members from various clubs. So I'm not going to venture into that. Anybody who is on the call, please take this down and you can ask your club secretaries, club presidents, or the senior members of the club and keep this information handy because this will motivate you, this will help you. You should know when your club was chartered, how many were the charter member, just information that you may or may not use ever. Who is your sponsoring club? What is the current membership? Both in terms of numbers and what kind of demographics that you have in your club. And if your club has sponsored any clubs, any other Lions clubs or Leo clubs, and what are the achievements? What are the significant awards and achievements of your club? You also need to know about the operations of your club. What are the long-standing traditions? If your club is new, you may not have those many traditions, but if your club is serving your communities long enough, there would be a lot of things that your club might be doing. You might have some signature service activities or fundraisers. Many of our clubs have the pancake breakfast or spaghetti dinners or fish fries and stuff like that. There are the fundraisers like the White Cane fundraiser. There are several such things that we have. There are several signature service activities that each club has. Just to give you an idea, my home club, we have, unfortunately, during the COVID that we couldn't do it, but we have the special needs social, the social for the people with special needs 4 times a year. That is our signature activity. So if your club has a signature service activity or fundraiser, you need to know when you join. Then your meeting schedule and meeting formats, your membership dues, and how the dues are spent, and the mode of communication. The newer clubs, they have the virtual digital mode of communication many times. Even before the pandemic, my club was doing our meetings on conference calls. I know many clubs that they have a WhatsApp group where they can put in their projects and ask for opinions and so on. So you have to understand the mode of communication. Then you need to know certain officers. PID Sangeeta did talk about variety of positions and what they do. The president, immediate past president, secretary treasurer, membership chair, service chair, marketing communication chair, past or district or international officers, if there are any into your club. Like as Sangeetaji mentioned, lion tamer, tail twister, directors, and so many things. But at least you need to know the basic position, president, secretary, treasurer, membership chair, service chair, so that you can bring up your ideas to the right person. Moving on to the district. The district, as I mentioned earlier, clubs become zones are like few zones are into a region. Region is a sort of an optional entity. We may have regions or we may not, but few of the zones are into a district. As Sangeetaji mentioned, we have districts. The minimum number of clubs required for a district is 35. We need to have 1,250 members to be a viable district. And multiple district is where you have more than one districts into one particular area. So I'm going to talk about district and multiple district for a moment. As I mentioned earlier, we have three districts in our multiple district 16, 16N, 16J, and 16L. The seven districts in North are 16N. The five districts in the Central Jersey are 16J, and the nine districts in South Jersey are 16L. So in this area, we have the, this is how our multiple district is formed. We have three sub-districts. So multiple district officers for next year. We have incoming council chair, Armando Guerra. He is on the call. Armando, can you wave? Yes, there he is. So Armando Guerra is the incoming council chair. I would be the incoming state advisor. And to support us, we have an office in Bridgewater, and our office manager is Kartika Gupta. I think I'm hiding her name. As I said, we are still yet to take the office. We still have another couple of weeks to go. Right now, we do have the sitting state advisor, Jack Romano, on the call. Jack, can you wave? You're not in my frame, but if you can wave, I will appreciate that. Okay, I'm assuming that Jack has waved. Our council chair couldn't come in today, and Kartika did not come in today, but. Okay, moving on. This is a general, I have to move on the other side. This is a general cabinet structure, district cabinet structure. The district is run like this. Again, I will send you this. We don't have to take any notes. I don't want to complicate. I'm already complicating after PID Sangeeta's free flow, nice presentation. So I'm just going to send it to you along with the attendance certificate that your governors are going to send. But meanwhile, this is just to give an idea. District governor is at the helm of the district cabinet. Then we have cabinet secretary, treasurer, region zone chairs who form the cabinet. And then there are several committees. Who are going to be the next year's officers? 16N, the incoming governor is Marie Nieto. Marie, can you wave, please? I'm just assuming that people are waving because I cannot see see that box. The first vice governor is going to be Kamlesh Patel. Second vice governor is going to be John Carroll. Cabinet secretary is Matthew Pavanelli and Matt Pavanelli. And treasurer is going to be John Pincus. 16J, we have the sitting governor, DG Kevin Kasubuki is here. Kevin, can you please wave to our new members?
Hello.
Yes, good. Then we have the governor, incoming governor, Varsha Naik, incoming first vice governor, Cash Daluri. He is also on the call. Second vice governor, Evalio Salermo. I don't know whether I have not seen him yet, but he was supposed to be on the call. Our cabinet secretary for 16J is going to be John Sheskwa. And the treasurer is going to be Wendy Ziang. In 16L, I'm going to move myself, that will be easier. 16L, we have the incoming district governor, Doug Both, first vice governor, Eli Mateo. Second vice is going to be Donna Friedel. Secretary is going to be Terry Rosiak, and the treasurer is going to be Tina Song. So these are the leaders that are going to help you during the next year to improve your service impact. Also, one thing that is important that has been key leaders in helping all our clubs, all our members, is the Global Action Team. The Global Action Team is like the ingredients for Global Action Team are three: global membership, global leadership, and global service. The global membership in 16N is led by Lou Lambie. Leadership is led by Brad Day. Service is led by Nick Landy. And we have a new element now for last 3 years, and we will be talking about that in detail tomorrow, the global membership approach. The global membership approach leader for the next year in 16L is going to be Lou Lambie. 16J, the GMT, global membership, is led by Peter Twill. Leadership would be led by Rohel Batista. Service would be led by Prashant Karnik. And the global membership approach would be led by yours truly. 16L, the global membership would be led by Bob Friedel. Leadership would be led by Clarence Brown. Service would be led by Kim Colgan, and GMA would be led by Bob Friedel. The multiple district team, which will work with Council Chair Armando Guerra, would be the global membership would be led by Bob Friedel. A global leadership would be led by Anu Chitnis. Global service would be led by current state advisor Jack Romano. And the global membership approach would be led by Bob Friedel. This is for you, again, this presentation, I will send it to you. You don't have to take the information down. Some facts about New Jersey. The first club in New Jersey was formed on December 15, 1920, more than 100 years back now in Camden. As I mentioned, the Melvin Jones was traveling, he entered into New Jersey, and the first train stop was in Camden, and he started a club there. He moved on to start club in Brunswick's, and then Perth Amboy, and so on. The total membership, I skipped one point. The three districts that we have, 16N, J, and L, we were redistricted in 2014, about 7 years back. Membership is 4,120, which comprises of N has 1,263, J has 1,441, and L has 1,460. The number of clubs in New Jersey are 171. N has 57 clubs, J has 58 clubs, and L has 56 club. So we are like sort of in the same range. The leadership in New Jersey, the leadership that our state has provided to international is our member from Newark, Benjamin Franklin Jones, was the international president in 1925-26. The story that PID Sangeeta mentioned, the challenge that was given to us by Helen Keller to be the Knights of Blind, to eradicate preventable blindness, that was accepted by Benjamin Franklin Jones. So the core cause that we got was first accepted by a New Jerseyan to give it to our entire Lions clubs. Benjamin Franklin Jones, another information that he was the Attorney General of New Jersey. So he was very, very influential in New Jersey also. The second international president that we had was Harold P. Nutter. He was a member of Camden Club, and he was a president between 1951 and 52. Then we have several international directors. Waylon Kramer was the international director between 1921 and 24. Before 1950s, we had the international director's term was 3 years. When Sangeetaji became the director, she had a 2 year term. So Way Kramer was a director for 3 years between 21 to 24. Harold Nutter was an international director between 42 and 48. That makes it 6 years. So Harold Nutter holds a record that he's the only director in the world ever to have two consecutive terms as a director. The Hubert Birum Jr. was a director between 57 and 59. If you see that, it's a 2 year term. Then Bill McCormick, his term was 1962 to 64. Max Strub was a governor between 66 and 60, not governor, director between 66 and 68. And John Swantek was the director between 1990. Then Gordon Post was the director between 85 and 87. Chuck Wimmer was the director between 93 and 95. Stan Grossman, who comes from our District 16J, he's our only living international director in our district. He was the director between 99 and 2001. Bob Moore, who belongs to 16N, again, he is the only living international director in North. He was the director between 2005 and 2007. In 16L, we have Mel Bray, who probably most of you have met. He was a governor between 2015 and 2017. And we have a candidate on the ballot, and we are pretty sure that he will be elected this year. Jeff Cairns from 16L would be our next international director, and his term will be to 2021 to 23. We are proud of hosting so many international conventions. We had our seventh international convention in 1923 in Atlantic City. All the convention that we hosted were in Atlantic City. So seventh international convention in 1923, 34th international convention is 1951, 38th in 1955, 44th in 1961, and 53rd in 1970. So we hosted five international convention in Atlantic City in last 100 years of our history. We have some really, really remarkable projects. As PID Sangeetaji was mentioning projects all around the world, we had some remarkable projects in in New Jersey. The Lion Sight Foundation, which was established in 1972, which now became the Lion's Eye Research Foundation, is a funding body for the eye-related research. We have a seat in the Rutgers Medical Center in Newark now, which used to be the UMDNJ. We provide a substantial funding for eye research in the Rutgers Medical School. We have the New Jersey Eyeglass Recycling Center, which was established in 1997, which is the third largest eyeglass recycling center in the world. We have the New Jersey Lions Eye Bank, which was established in 1970, which now has become a network of eye banks around the United States and abroad called Eversight. That was the transition happened in 2015. The New Jersey Eye Bank joined the Eversight in 2015. And we are also have Lions Eye Bank of Delaware Valley, which was established in 1957, which supports mostly the 16L. The Eversight supports 16N and J, whereas the Lions Eye Bank of Delaware Valley supports the southern part of our state. So that's all that I wanted to talk about, just to give you a tidbits of Lions trivia facts in New Jersey. So let's open this for the conversation, the questions if you have for PID Sangeeta ji. So I'm going to stop sharing my screen and we can have everybody on.
Thank you, Lion Mahesh, PCC Mahesh, for the wealth of information about our organizational structure and some trivia items. It's great to be a lion. It's great to be a New Jersey lion. At this point, we'll be having the answer and question and answer portion, and we will try our best to answer them all as much as we can in the time that we have. And we have one question here right now. Can you please tell us a little bit about New Voices program, and that's for PID Sangeeta.
Thank you very much. New Voices was a program which was initiated by our international president 2 years back. That was the first woman to become an international president, Gudrun Ingwerdotter. And when she started off, you know, when we started the organization, we, till 1987, when women were not allowed to become members, women became Lion members. So then only it was a men's club. It was a businessmen's club, as they were called. And women allowed, and you know, Lion ladies clubs. We didn't have women as members of Lions clubs. They did not have a right to vote. But in 1987, this got changed. And then women started becoming members of the association. Now, since 1987 and now, we definitely have our membership strength today is 30% of the members worldwide are women. In some areas, it is higher. For example, in South America, we have more than 50% members as women. But in some other parts, it's maybe 25%, in some places, 28%. So we thought that what we need to do is have a marketing program, have a recruiting program, whereby we can recognize women and also create an atmosphere where more women can join the organization. Because you can understand, for 70 years, we did not have women in this organization. So that, you know, it became branded as an organization of only men. So the focus of New Voices was to focus on those women who are part of the organization, but not necessarily Lion members, and promote them, get them on leadership positions. Because although the women membership was growing, our leadership was not growing. Women leadership was not growing. And the pool of leaders that we require were not, you know, increasing as much as should have increased. So it was decided that, you know, we should do a program whereby we can focus on these women and get them to come and, you know, get out of their shell, if you may, ask them to showcase their activities so that they themselves get inspired and they can also inspire other women. So this is how the New Voices program was started. It was all about creativity. It was all about innovation. It was all about showcasing those women leaders who have been doing incredible work, but somehow they did not occupy leadership positions. The first year, it was only focused on women. And following 2 years, they expanded the program New Voices, and it also encompassed young lions, young in age, young adults, who were doing exceptional service, you know, because we have a very hierarchical setup. Badges, like you just heard, past directors, past presidents, past governors, past council chairpersons, state advisors, what have you. We have a whole lot of positions in this organization. So sometimes it becomes very, you know, very difficult for those who do not want to occupy a position to come forward. So the New Voices program was to give voice to those women who have been working but do not occupy a position, and thereby either motivating them to occupy a position and take up leadership positions, or to at least bring their activities on the forefront. So it was, the program was, you know, amplifying their voice, getting them across, getting their message across. And as I said, it's no longer just a women's initiative. It is a program so that we also focus on youth and women, so that these are these two groups of people whom we have in a little minority in our organization. So we would like more young people to join us, more women to join us. So the New Voices program is basically a focus on getting new people, new ideas into this organization. So that's what New Voices is all about. It still continues with a focus on identifying young people, women who have done, who are doing work, who have a lot of talent, and who can showcase their talent to the world and thereby be an inspiration. That's what New Voices is all about. I see a question. Who introduced you as to the Lions? Oh, very simple. My grandfather was a Lion member. He did not become a district governor, but he fought to become a district governor and he lost his elections. My father, when my grandfather was there, my mother was a very active Lion. But at that point of time, a woman could not become a Lion member. She could not even become a Lioness member. And your husband had to become a, I mean, we had a very patriarchal kind of a society, I think, in Lions also at that point of time. So if my mother had to become a Lioness member at that time, my father had to become a Lion member. So he became a Lion member so that my mother could become a Lioness member. And then my father went on to become a district governor, a director, and he's also a past international director today. And it came in my genes together because all of them were in Lions. I had no intention of becoming a Lion member. When I became a club president, I became a club president. I don't even have any recollection of what I did as a club president because, you know, my father was there, my mother was there, everybody pushed me kind of. And it was like home, you know, at home, all that they spoke about was Lions. So we always knew about it. But I did not want to become a president. I did not want to have anything to do with Lions. And still I became a president in 1990, I think. Till 1998, I had no intention. I had, don't even remember what I did. But only after 1998, something sucked me in. And that what sucked me in was my father had his international director campaign, elections. You spoke about politics, right? So that is when, because there was a lot of politics there and he needed support and I was his daughter and I, you know, he lost the first elections. And I felt very bad that he's lost an election and I could not even support him. So just to support him in his elections, I became active in this organization. So my initiation in this organization is because of politics, pure politics. So I got here because I wanted to help my father in his election. And in the course of helping him in the elections, I kind of got sucked in into this entire system. And once the system sucks you in, there's no going out. You become married to it for life. And that virus still with me. And I think it gets stronger by the day. So this is how I got into this organization. It's a very different kind of a story. And because somebody spoke about politics before, I hope it had a positive impact on me. It made me a Lion too. So, you know, politics is going to be there. And that is why I'm here today.
Thank you, PID Sangeeta. Is there any other question at this point? You may raise your hands. If you
I see one question. What would you say is your one emotional connection in Linism? One emotional connection? There are so many. You know, every service activity you do, the moment you do something, the smile on that person's face, I tell you, the hands-on service that we do is what really keeps us going. And I think that's the key which gets and pulls us back into this organization, which sometimes is crazy, you know. I know for one, Mahesh has been last seven hours, he must have been doing one Lions meeting after the other. We hop from meeting to the other. Even if we have no role to play, we are still there. We enjoy it because it's of the, you know, the passion that the connect that we've been able to have now, thanks to this network that we have created. So emotions is definitely with service activities, but I think the friendships that we have created over the world, the networks that we have now is what keeps drawing me back for sure. I mean, it's nice to say, very noble to say that service draws me in, but I think it's the friendships which actually draws me in. The service gives you the kind of impetus to, you know, keep on doing this fundraising and doing all those projects, but it's the networks which really, really makes, I think, you know, keeps you connected to this organization.
Anybody else?
Rohel, we have one hand raised and he just sent me a message that he can't write. So can we allow him to ask a question to Sangeeta ji?
Yes, you can.
RM, and he's Rahul More. Yeah.
Yeah, if you could, I have to look, if you could unmute him or her.
I will unmute him.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Yes, Rahul, you can ask a question. Yeah.
Hey, thanks a lot, Varsha. Thanks, Ryan Mahesh, and thanks, everyone. So, Sangeeta ji, this is Rahul. Believe me, I am inspired by you when I joined the voice workshop with you in Edison first time. You were talking about stories of how water is faced in India and how challenging situation is there. So my question to you and all senior Lions here, even goes to Mahesh also, who is my mentor also. What makes you guys continue for hours together? Partially you answered it. Continue for hours together. Getting into meetings after meeting is one part. But thinking about and bringing this innovative ideas, something different, how that you guys bring it to the table all the time. If you can share some light on that, that would be really great.
You know, I think what we have, as I said, is a great network. And I think Mahesh will agree with me. Each one gets, you know, like if you work with the best of the best, what happens? It kind of rubs it into you. And you always want to do something even better, right? Till now we had one competition, Mahesh Chitnis. Now we have two competition, Mahesh and Ojas. Both are competition. So you've got to, you know, match them up. Do a little bit better than them. So that is how I think competition comes up. And that competition is healthy competition. And that what keeps us going. And the fact that we can, you know, work, learn from each other, work with each other. I think each one allows us and you learn so much. You learn so much and it kind of, you know, I don't know. You enjoy when you're with good friends, don't you? So now our friendships have become such that we work together, learn together, eat together. We would spend days together and I think we won't get bored. So because there is so much to share and I think it gives us so much, you know, these experiences that we have of service, the experiences that we have of leadership training, I think all of that, it's like a full package. I can't tell you this is like, you know, this is that one thing that connects us. It's just everything. And that is why at times we act crazy, we think, do things crazy, and this kind of has become our lifestyle.
Thanks a lot for that, Sangeeta.
I would use the keyword from PID Sangeeta's, it becomes a lifestyle. Lionism is a lifestyle. We always have, and again, this happens with everybody who is involved in Lionism. The Lionism becomes your friend circle and your friend circle becomes Lions. So we are always there and we That is what we enjoy. I jumped down to Mike for one reason. Those who did not see a series by PID Sangeeta and PID AP called The Diversity in Service, they have collected the different projects from different parts of the world on particular topic. Diabetes, they did one on diabetes, they did one on education and so on. They had like 8 part series. So I'll try to get you the links if you have not watched it already. It was, that motivates me to think out of box, and that will do that to you also.
Thank you, Mahesh.
Thank you. Thank
you. We are having a great event on the 11th of July. Keep your eyes out for that. I think that'll be a fun event. We can't advertise it right away, but we will hear, you'll hear about it very soon. Ojas has a question. My God.
I do. Ojas Chitness from the Edison Visionary Club. One question that I have for you is, if there's new lions like myself who maybe hesitant or unsure about whether they want to step up within the association, take a leadership role within their club or their district, what advice do you have for them who may be on this call?
If you are hesitant, I have nothing else to say. But then why should you be hesitant? I mean, I think there is so much here. You know, there is an opportunity, and the opportunity needs to be grabbed. As you know, today in the world, if you want to do something, it's not going to come to you. Like Helen Keller told us in 1925, opportunity is not going to knock twice. So what I say, would suggest is take the opportunity. You might do it well. You might not be a fantastic success. So what? At least you tried. I think that's what's important. And I think this organization gives us the leverage so that we can, you know, do as much as we can. And it really, sometimes I feel it gets the best out of us because there is no pressure as such. And we, and at times that competition also, you know, that which exists, if you want to look at it, there is also competition. So it's a very healthy mix. It's not as if somebody is stressing you out, but again, it gives you an opportunity to do your best. And there is no end to the creativity because there are no set parameters. You can do just what you like in this organization. I think that's what I like best about it. You can think out of the box and you'll always find takers for it. So I believe there is, you know, you just got to give it. And I don't think there's a hesitancy, not in the your generation, or just come on. That could be a hesitation in some other generations, but I don't think the generation that you guys belong to, I tell you, you all are phenomenal. And the way you come out, so I should ask you that question. You give us a few tips. And how did we, you know, how do we get that confidence? So I think that is, there is nothing, no rocket science in this organization. Really, there's nothing. Every position is very easy to hold. And you can innovate and, you know, create, do use it creatively. So if you take it that way, you can just occupy anything. And nowadays, we're having so many young people coming up and taking up positions. We have young directors coming up, young presidents coming in now. So I think that's a fantastic sign. Our organization is growing younger. That's good. You're muted.
Anybody else has a question? Please raise your hand. Come on, let's take advantage of PID Sangeeta's presence with us.
It's been a long evening, I think.
Nobody? Any thoughts, Lion Varsha, before I proceed?
No, it was great, and it was always nice to hear from Sangeeta ji, and always we learn something new. Today I learned a lot of things, so thank you so much, and thank you so much PCC Mahesh for giving us insight about our multiple district 16. Thank you so much.
Okay, so before we go to the last part of this evening's activity, we still have time, right?
Rohel, we have a couple of other questions in the chat box.
Oh, let's see.
PDG Don Kosubuki writes, how do you encourage newer lions to donate to LCIF?
Okay. Well, I think it's, you know, the good that they see. We should talk about the good that the foundation has done. And the foundation has done so much good. The moment people see that, they understand that this is an organization where you can give. And as I said, not one penny, 1 cent, one paisa, as we tell it in our part of the world, does not go towards administration. Whatever you give goes directly to the beneficiary. I think that is the biggest strength our organization has, our foundation has. Because you look at any other charity, you pick up any organization, and if you would just study, you would see at least 20%, 30% of the money that you donate goes to the administrative costs. But our organization is one where the administrative costs are kept to a minimal, and that administrative cost is paid through by the interest that we have accrued through our, the trust, the money that we have collected in our foundation. So I think that's something so fantastic. The moment people hear that, they know that whatever, however much they are giving is going straight to charity. I think that's what really makes people contribute to our foundation, I think. And now we have so many different kinds of grants. Earlier, we used to have only those big grants. Now they started doing these small community grants. So every club, if they want, can take advantage of it. And now that we have the system that even if you donate money to the foundation, you are eligible for a grant after a couple of years when there's a certain amount of money reached. Your club can also ask for that small grant. So, you know, it's a way of giving and you get back too. So I think that's also a great encouragement to Lions to donate.
I'm looking at this chat box and I want to make sure I read everything there. I don't see any more questions, but we still have time, right? 8:46.
Yeah, Ojas is right. We also have programs for individual Lions, of course, the Lion Share program. And now I believe even the Leos have a program by which they can be recognized if they donate as much as $20. So I think that's fantastic. They want everybody to participate. We want everybody to participate in the foundation now. Contribute to the foundation. It's your foundation. And the foundation really does good across the world, around the world. And so many projects that are running through it. I mean, it's really fantastic the way it comes out. For COVID, the way it has supported India is just fantastic. We've got oxygen banks running. We've got hundreds and hundreds of oxygen, concentrators coming in. I think that has really made a difference. Lions have done tremendous amount of work during this pandemic, thanks to our foundation.
A lot of information there. District Governor-elect Marie, do you have any thoughts?
I think it was, I loved everything that she said. It was wonderful. And anybody who has any second thoughts on becoming a Lion, if they have any second thoughts at all, everything was said, it's a lot to absorb, but I think it was wonderful. She captivated every part of Lionism. Every point that there is to think about why you would want to become a member, why not? Why not? There is everything is there. It's like, why not be a member? Why not be a Lion? That is my question to anyone. Why not be a Lion? Now you tell me why not be a Lion. So I think it's all there.
Thank you, DG Marie. Let's also ask First District Governor of 6NJ, Lion Cash. Any thoughts? First District Vice Governor.
Rohel, you were breaking up, so I think he did not hear you. Lion Cash?
Lion Cash, you're on mute. We can't hear you.
Yeah, now I'm on mute. Thank you so much. I put in the chat box, I want to thank PID Sangeeta for beautiful presentation that she did today. Like I said, I always introduce myself as a passionate lion for 25, 26 years now, but I never knew the true meaning which she has expressed, which she has elaborated in front of us. What an amazing experience that she has put forth in front of us. And I'm sure you, every one of us will must be fascinated and I love to be a lion. Thank you so much, Sangeeta. Thank you.
Thank you, pleasure, thank you.
Thank you, Lioncast.
Pleasure.
District Governor Lion Kevin, any thoughts?
That was a great presentation. The only thing I'm going to push is LCIF. This year we did very good. Next year, I think we can do a lot better. In fact, I know we can. We've been averaging 10% in the past few years. This year, we've done 30% over last year, and we will hit our goals. But it's all up to you people. I love the idea of Leo 100% clubs. I know a couple of clubs are working towards it. The community grants, those are great ways to go. We've actually used one of them here in Jay, where we helped purchase a forklift for the eye bank. When you're moving that many glasses, you need a way to help make it work. But great presentation. I can't wait to see the other. Well, I got to miss one because I'm going to be at a club event Wednesday night. But other than that, I'm going to hopefully be at everything else. Have a great year, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you, Lion Kevin. Let's hear from PCC Jack Romano. Your thoughts.
Good evening, everyone. There's not much else to add. I think everything that had to be said needed to be said. District Governor-elect Marie's point, you know, it's not why be a lion, why not be a lion? And again, my best wishes to the incoming administrations. I think we have a good team and hopefully everybody will have a good year. Let's put it this way. We won't have a year with a pandemic, so it'll definitely be a good year.
Things are looking better, yeah. And let's see, PCC Minister Ceballos. I can't find him. I think he is here.
I'm here. Yeah. I'm here. I mean, it's not much to say, like Jack said. I mean, thank you, PID Sangeeta, for your presentation. A lot of good information that will help our members grow. Looking forward for the next four presentations during this week. And congratulations to the team that put this series together. Great job.
Thank you, PCC Winster. Now, we have a few more minutes. Anybody else would like to say something with regard to what PID Sangeeta talked about or anything related to it?
Well, I'd just like to thank you, Lion Rohel, for hosting this program today. And I'm sure that it's going to be a great program for the next 4 days. And I'm very excited to see what the future holds for all of us here in Multiple District 16 and District 16 today.
Thank you, Lion Oz. Okay, let's see. Okay, no more questions?
Yeah, with the one more thing, I just wanted to thank the PAD Sangeeta for being our special guest speaker, and you are a precious jewel in Lions, and we are lucky to have we're lucky to have you. So thank you for sharing all your knowledge. We appreciate you. Thank you, Rahel. Thank you, Mahesh, and thank you all the Lions that are here to absorb all that knowledge. And remember, it's not your aptitude, it's your attitude that will raise you to your altitude. Right? It's all about attitude in life that will actually raise you to your altitude. So All right, let's continue to grow as a team. Let's all harness our energies and focus on Linism and service. Thank you.
Thank you, Lion Armando. GLT Chair incoming, Lion Anu.
What can I say? PID Sangeeta Ji, thank you very much. We really appreciate. And I think as, even though I don't like to do that in public, thank you, Mahesh, for your presentation as well. It was very informative for MD60.
Thank you, Lion Anu. We'd like to stay much longer, but it looks like it's been a long evening. So before we go to the last part of this evening's activity, before we close, we have some announcements to make. Tomorrow at the same time, 7 to 9 p.m., we'll have the second part of the training, a refresher on the subject global membership approach. I hope everyone here has also registered for tomorrow's event. And on Wednesday, we'll have the president and the club leadership. On Thursday, digital resources, my favorite, my Lion, my LCI. And on Friday, the role of secretary and treasurer. All of these are same time, 7 to 9. And each session is very important, so please consider registering to all of them. And I'd like to take this opportunity to acknowledge the presence of Lions here tonight. PID Sangeeta, thank you for sharing your time, your effort, and your wisdom on the topic that we had tonight. May you be blessed always, especially in your Lion journey.
Thank you. Thank you so much for this opportunity. It was a pleasure. Thank you.
And I'd also like to thank, of course, incoming state advisor, Mahesh Chitnis, PCC Mahesh Chitnis, state advisor and PCC Jack Romano, PCC Winston Ceballos, and Council Chair-elect Armando Guerra, District Governor Kevin Kosubuki, PDG Don Kosubuki. And we also have a PDG from the Philippines, PDG Ruth Chua. Thanks for joining us. And we have thank you also to District Governor-elect Marie Perez Nieto, DGE of 16J, of course, our very own Varsha Naik. Thank you for the lot of your effort and a lot of time that you have put into this. And of course, our first Vice District Governor incoming, 16J of Cass DeLore.
Thank you.
And we also have here District 16J Treasurer Diane Andrade. And we have multiple District 16 GLT incoming Chair, Lion Anu Chitnis. And for all, and of course, we have the Leo Lion, Ohas Chitnis from the Leo Leadership. It's great to have you with us. And I believe there are some Leos or Leo Lions here. Did you notice? But anyway, thank you all for joining us tonight, for making this event possible. And before we end, I'd like to share some favorite lines of mine, which to me is timeless. Its message spans across the time and space and culture, that of Mother Teresa. PID Sangeeta mentioned about her earlier. Mother Teresa is the ultimate icon of service for me. And there are verses found in her room, in her wall, that's widely attributed to her. It's called Do It Anyway. Maybe some of you have heard it already, but it talks a lot about our service, our being part of an organization, of being part of the world, touching its others' lives. And I want to read it. People are often unreasonable, irrational, and self-centered. Forgive them anyway. If you are kind, people may accuse you of selfish, ulterior motives. Be kind anyway. If you are successful, you will win some unfaithful friends and some genuine enemies. Succeed anyway. If you are honest and sincere, people And sincere people may deceive you. Be honest and sincere anyway. What you spend years creating, others could destroy overnight. Create anyway. If you find serenity and happiness, some may be jealous. Be happy anyway. The good you do today will often be forgotten. Do good anyway. Mm-hmm. Give the best you have, and it will never be enough. Give your best anyway. In the final analysis, it is between you and God. It was never between you and them anyway.
Very nice.
Good night, everyone. Stay safe and see.